The University of Tennessee celebrates Title IX at 50 and our proud history of being the standard bearer of women's collegiate athletics. Hear the stories of true pioneers who combined vision and purpose to change the landscape of sports.
Hi everyone, I'm Casey Funderburg. Thank you for joining us as we celebrate 50 years of Title IX. Tonight I'm joined by a panel of individuals who helped shape women's athletics at the University of Tennessee and around the country. With us tonight is Holly Warlick. Holly Warlick spent time as a player, assistant coach, and head coach of the Lady Vol basketball team. She boasts 1,121 wins combined in those roles. Holly is the first player in Tennessee history to have her jersey retired. Joan Cronin. Joan served as women's athletic director at Tennessee from 1983 to 2012. Lady Vol Athletics won 10 national championships and 33 SEC tournament championships during her tenure. Joan was also head coach of the Lady Vol basketball team from 1968 to 1970. Doug Dickey. Doug Dickey led the Tennessee football team from 1964 to 69 and later served as athletic director from 1985 to 2002. Coach Dickey partnered with the Lady Vol Athletic Department to promote and advance the experience of Lady Vol athletes. India Childs. India was a member of the Lady Vol softball team from 2004 to 2007, playing in three Women's College World Series. During her career, she was named 2007 SEC Player of the Year and earned All-American honors. Donna Thomas. Donna filled several roles in her time at Tennessee, including Senior Woman Administrator. Donna was a basketball manager under Pat Summitt and was instrumental in planning and the dedication of the Pat Summitt Plaza. Maya Neal. Maya was a dual sport athlete at Tennessee from 2015 to 2019, earning all SEC honors four times as a soccer player and All-American honors as a heptathlete. Maya was also recognized for her academics and her work in the community. Benita Fitzgerald Mosley. Benita was a Lady Vol track and field athlete from 1980 to 1983 and helped the Lady Vols to a national championship in 1981. Benita was an eight-time national champion and 14-time All-American during her time on Rocky Top. Debbie Jennings. Debbie spent 35 years as a media relations director for the Lady Vols and is widely recognized for her creativity with Lady Vol Media Guide themes. Debbie was a pioneer for the advancement of women's athletics. Coach Dickey, I want to start with you. What was it like in the 50s and 60s for women's athletics?
Well, I wasn't here in the 50s, but I was here in the 60s. Actually, I came here as a player in the 50s against Tennessee. Mm-hmm. But in the 60s, it was a time where we had urban renewal that wiped out a whole bunch of houses on the west end of this campus. Coach Woodruff got busy and got some donations and built a track. And he built the university built a very fine swimming complex. So we had some coaches that came on in the 60s that sort of helped set a standard of achievement here between Ray Mears, Ray Buzzard, Chuck Rowe, and myself. We won a lot of conference championships and some national championships, and it set a new standard that had been set by Bob Nealon in the late 30s. But there was a new standard set in the 60s, and there were very few women team sports of any sort in the 60s. Individual women competed, but it was not until the Title IX passed in the 70s and we began to build that the women's team sports became important. The University of Tennessee, I think, recognized that it could be a national contender in all sorts of sports. And Coach Woodruff, I think, was very important in setting that all sports were important to the university, not only the football program, but all sports, including the women's sports, then came out of the Title IX of the 1970s.
The addition of the track and the swimming facility, why were those two additions so instrumental in playing a part with women's athletics?
Well, the track and the swimming area over there were certainly sports that were Olympic sports for women already. And so when we put those facilities in, then the development of those team sports were used, the facilities that had been built in the 60s. And it wasn't until the 70s that those really came about.
Joan, what were some key differences that stuck out to you before Title IX came into the picture?
Well, when I think about women's athletics before then, we were just club sports. And we didn't have the media, we didn't have the publicity. But when Title IX became law, it made people to pay attention. And I think what happened at Tennessee is we like to win, and we like to have big facilities, and we like to compete. And we've had a great football program, a great track program, and they said, why not women? And we had the fortune, a lot of us on the stage here, to take that and run with that ball. We worked with Coach Dickey in men's athletics. We were always separate, but we were always partners, and we always felt good about supporting each other. And I guess the key to our success was really working together.
Debbie, when did you realize what was happening at the University of Tennessee was different and that we were trailblazers in women's athletics?
I think 1976 was the first time that, as sports editor of the Beacon my senior year and traveling around the conference and to different places, mostly outside of Tennessee, regionally, I could see what their programs did or didn't have. And women's athletics was new here. It had just been started. But the foundation and the people they had in place and the student athletes they had at the time were so overachieving and so dedicated that I could see that something really great was going to be built at Tennessee. I remember when I started in 1977, when I walked into the office the first day, Gloria Ray, our athletics director, and Terry Crawford came up to me, and I'm a fresh college graduate, I've never done this job before, and they said, we won the bid to host the AIAW National Track and Field Championships, and that's going to be our main focus, and we've got to do better than the school that just hosted and put them on. And they did the best job they've ever done. Well, I'm like 22, and I'm like, oh my gosh, what have I gotten into? And, you know, we had to do better than UCLA. And so, you know, that set the standard. That dressed the table right there from the jump that we were to do it absolutely first class in every way, and we were to make the student-athlete experience, whether it was for our student-athletes that were competing, this was going to be the place that they wanted to come to compete because it was first class all the way. And I think that really just kind of perpetuated into the staff, small staff, you know, everybody did nine jobs, but there wasn't a job that was too big or too small. Everybody just chipped in and did what they had to do. And I think because of that, that foundation was so strong to begin with, especially with people like Terry Crawford and Pat Head Summit at the time to get this started with Gloria Ray heading it up, and then Joan coming and taking us to the next level.
What was that like at the beginning when it was such a small staff and you all were having to figure out who played what role and what you all needed to do to create that standard of excellence that you all were trying to achieve?
You know, we jumped in and it was one for all and all for one. And so it didn't matter what the situation was. You know, I traveled with all five teams, and which was kind of, you know, a little difficult to do. But I know Mary Jane Ramsey Garcia, our tennis coach, was pregnant. They didn't know when she was about to deliver. So I had to take the tennis team to UT Martin and coach them at UT Martin in a tournament. So you just kind of stepped in and you did whatever you needed to do. And that was the philosophy that we started with, and I think that carried through the entire time that I was at Tennessee. Everybody helped each other recruit. You know, if Pat went somewhere and saw an athlete that also played volleyball, there was a lot of networking going on to help identify the talent and to, you know, get back with each other and say, hey, this is what I've seen. Have you heard about this, you know, this student athlete? And then the last thing, the E was it exclusively something different that we were doing that nobody else in the country was doing that was going to be different for the student athlete? And so the growth of the Booster Club, big part of our success, because we were starting to have people that believed in paying for scholarships and helping us out there. We were doing things way ahead of our time, and they just made the student athlete experience just as amazing as it could be. And as that grew, we started recruiting nationally, and I remember when we got our first West Coast volleyball player, it was like, we've arrived. But before, it was, if your state touched the border of Tennessee, you were probably going to be, you know, competing at Tennessee, because that's where kind of recruiting was. You didn't go outside the borders of your state very far. And that's the way it was until things changed in 82 when we joined the NCAA, and then that changed the dynamics.
You know, to follow up on Debbie, one of the things when I came in 1983, I can remember we had a strong men's program. We had great people in the women's program. And I kind of looked at it, I said, ESPN came and said, you know, what about Tennessee? Are y'all are successful, why are you successful? And I simply said, we've got great people. And we did. We had people that cared. And I said that we had great people. They had a passion about what we were doing and took a lot of pride. And those three things, I think, were the ground that we built ourselves on. We had passion, we had pride, we had great people. And if I could add another thing, I think we communicated well among ourselves. We communicated well within the university and in the community, and we became a factor. People knew who the Lady Vols were.
Speaking of the Lady Vols and the Lady Vol logo, can you tell the story of how this logo came to be and why you all wanted it to be separate from just Tennessee and why you all wanted it to stand out nationally?
I'd like Debbie to tell that a little bit better, or Donna, because they were here before I was as far as the logo was concerned. I inherited and I loved it, and I still love it.
Well, you know, the story of getting the napkin and writing out the Lady Vol logo, the hollow T, with the script Lady Vol. They went through several different versions of that, but there was input from Joy Scruggs. I mean, remember Joy telling the story how the coaches got everybody together, because most of them were PE majors at the time, and they're like, we're all going to meet and we're going to try and come up with our logo, and we want it to be a little different, a little special, so we stand out. And the bantering back and forth about the name and things like that, the Volettes and such. And so they came up with this kind of crude little on the napkin, bar napkin thing. And Ted Williams in UT Graphic Arts was the guy selected to take a look at that and with his vision decide what the final draft was going to look like, what the colors were going to be. You know, they wanted something in a Carolina blue, Columbia blue. And so that was really kind of the genesis of the logo. And, you know, it's a brand that's, you know, known worldwide. And, you know, from those kind of humble beginnings, you know, the Lady Vol flag, when it flies, everybody knows exactly who you're talking about.
I'll take one piece of credit here. In 1968, I was basketball coach here, and I think we were the Volettes or something exciting like that. But I was in the basement of Alumni Gym. I had a very little budget, and I had to order uniforms. And I could find, many people weren't playing women's basketball at that time. I could find white uniforms with Tennessee orange letters. But I couldn't find anybody that was making women's orange uniforms. And so I had a choice. I could get men's uniforms or come up with a third color. Without a marketing study, without an okay from anybody, I sat in the basement of Alumni Gym and said, what color do you think looks good with orange and white? And I said, Carolina blue. So if you go back to the 1968 to 72 teams, we wore blue uniforms with orange letters and white trim.
Donna, what are your thoughts on the logo and why is it so important?
I think because it is universally recognizable. Our coaches and student athletes traveled the world. And you almost never went somewhere where you didn't see that logo. I mean, Benita can probably tell you, even in the early days when she was, she's a gold medalist, so she was competing a lot in the Olympics, and Holly was competing a lot internationally. And people had that logo then, and people have it now. And it's always been iconic among our peers. Mostly, I think, because perhaps it was one of the first ones that was different. It wasn't the same logo for the male counterpart. And I think that set it apart. It made it special for our student athletes. It also made it special for our fan base. And I believe that that's one of the things that sort of from the roots kept the staying power, if you will.
Benita, we've talked a lot about the logo and what it means, and you have been a wonderful representative of what it means to be a Lady Vol. Why did you want to be an athlete here at the University of Tennessee?
Terry Crawford was the head coach here at Tennessee when I attended, and every year I would come here to the Lady Vol track class, I mean to the Vol track classic, a high school meet. It was a big meet. Kids from all over the Southeast would come. I think it's still going on today. My high school coach grew up in Maryville, Tennessee, so she loved coming back here for this meet. We'd get on the road in our van from Northern Virginia, and 8 or 10 of us packed in the van would come down. But, you know, we were part of AIAW at the time, and so you couldn't get many visits. And my parents couldn't afford to fly me all over the place, but 60, 70 schools were recruiting me and offering me full scholarships all over the country. But Tennessee, you know, had a place in my heart because I'd been here. I already felt like a Lady Vol long before I ever walked on campus as a student athlete. And honestly, whenever the signing day was, I just wanted to make a decision, and it was the easiest, simplest decision I ever made.
Holly, you were a dual sport athlete here. You competed in the AIAW League, and then later you coached in the NCAA era. Can you talk about the differences from playing in one era
Sure.
and then coaching in another?
As Joan said, I started my career playing basketball at an alumni gym, and it was all wooden seats, stage on one side of the court. Seats were up top, and the administration made a decision for us to go to Stokely Athletic Center. And I got the chance to help Trish Roberts break the scoring record by 51 points because I missed so many layups. She would just trail and put the ball in. So I such a difference between facilities, budgets. We used to travel with a station wagon with Pat driving and a van with Pat driving, a station wagon with our assistant coach driving with the luggage. So the administration decided, you know what, we're going to put money into women's athletics. And being great or getting a program where it needs to be doesn't just happen. You've got to have support. Obviously, you got to have great coaches. We had Pat Summit or Pat Head at the time. But you had athletic directors, you had administrators, you had Doug Dickey, you had the president of the university deciding that, you know, this is important. Women's athletics is important. Budgets got better. You know, people started coming out. I can always remember Pat saying, you know, the guys would get 80 pairs of tennis shoes. She would say, you know what, that's great, but we don't need 80 pairs of tennis shoes. We need to get what we need. And so I think it's so special to have the commitment from the university, and that's the only way you're going to make it. You are going to make it with boosters. You're going to make it with great people, but you got to have that support. And I think that's what Tennessee did, and I've just seen it over the years happen.
I would also just add, you know, as a student athlete here, you never wanted for anything.
Yeah.
And maybe we didn't have an overabundance of anything, but we never wanted for anything. And I remember we would go to meets like the NCAA championships or Penn relays where you'd run day after day after day. And every day we'd have a new uniform on, right? A different, not brand new necessarily, but a different uniform on.
Yeah.
We never had to wash it out. We knew that Joan and the athletic department had our back and that women's sports were a priority. I mean, if I needed to go to the Melrose Games or to a national championship or to an invitational someplace, Terry always sent me to where the best competition was. She never held that budget back for any reason. And so I always felt like I was completely supported and nurtured the whole time I was here, and all my teammates felt the same way.
India and Maya, when you hear these stories of how this brand came to be, what goes through your mind? Because when you all got here, the Lady Vol brand was already widely known and recognized.
A lot of people don't know, but I was not going to play softball in college. I was following my brothers in their basketball recruiting. And what I wasn't seeing was, I didn't want to play nice, and I don't mean sportsmanship, but I wanted to get dirty, I wanted to get gritty, and I wanted to win. And I wanted to be pushed like my brothers were on the court. And this was the place where the only place where I felt like I would be respected as a female athlete, where I would be pushed to succeed and pushed to win. And it wasn't just from my coaches the weeklies. It was everywhere, you know? Like probably most people on my visit, they say, what do you want to do? I want to meet Pat Summitt, right? I knew what she represented. I was coming to Tennessee anyway on an academic scholarship already. And then the weekly showed up in their orange and white to watch a game, and I'm thinking, what are they doing here, right? But my brothers in recruiting, it was a family decision. Those coaches would come and sit on the couch, and they would say, we're going to take care of your son. And UT was the only place that really spoke to all of us as a family and said, we're going to take care of your daughter, but we're going to allow her to express herself, to compete, and to win. And that was huge for me. If I was going to continue athletics, I just wanted an equal playing ground. And from Pat Summitt to the weeklies to Joan Cronin, everyone made that clear. You're here, we're going to take care of you, but we want to win. And that's really all I could ask for.
And for me during the recruiting process, I believed like wholeheartedly that the people make the place. Because even though Tennessee wasn't on my radar initially, right when I got the call, I thought, why not give it a chance? And coming on campus, it opened my mind and to limitless opportunities, whether it be on the track, on the field, or outside of the classrooms, because of people, like the people around me right now that laid the foundation for the Lady Vol brand. And I can wear that proudly and say that I was a student as well as an athlete here. And that's what attracted me to a place like Tennessee.
You know, I think too, I always say Tennessee is different. And what separates Tennessee from everybody else is the support for each other, willing to recruit for other teams, and just wanting everybody to do so well. And it truly is a family. I know that's kind of a cliche, but it does feel like, it felt like that down from the administration to each team and each team member. And when you see other teams go and watch a softball game or you go watch a soccer game, that's special. And you don't get that at a lot of places. And I think that was started from a foundation of the commitment for women's athletics here at Tennessee.
Next week, we'll have part two of our discussion with this esteemed panel.